Stand up, Detroit. This is your boy Luis Monte, and you tuned in to Jose Davale, aka Mr. Lit Entertainment himself, at the Freestyle After Dark Show. Keep it locked.
Your heart away. Still your heart away. If I could tell you something, everyone, it's the one and only D-Marie of DME Music. And you are now tuned in to the Freestyle After Dark Late Show with my boys, Lit Entertainment. Let's go.
What's up, everybody? I want to welcome you to Freestyle After Dark. We are bringing it to you live here from Lit Music Entertainment Studios here in Detroit. Yo, do we got a night for you. Tonight, we are trying to stay on schedule. We're trying to get off here at about 1 a.m. So tonight, you're rocking with Jose, Mr. Lit Entertainment, live right here in Detroit. Man, do I got a lot of announcements that I want to announce tonight. We are dropping it like it's hot. First, I want to actually welcome F. King Vodka. F. King Vodka, Four Kings, Not God's Vodka. This is straight Detroit-based, Chicago-based vodka. They just became our sponsors for Lit Music Entertainment. Yo, corporate sponsors, rocking it here live. So if you're at the store, pick up F. King Vodka. It's dope. We just met these guys tonight. We were at a networking event because, as you already know, as of August 7th and August 8th, we're dropping it right now. Tickets will be on sale as of tomorrow for the first annual Detroit Freestyle Music Festival. Yo, pup, do me a favor, yo. I want you to go into the first scene, the live and the mix. It's going to say the festival. It's going to say music festival. And we're going to drop the pick. We're going to drop the flyer right now. We're dropping the flyer for you, how it's going to look on the billboard. So, people, check this out, yo. Check this out right here. You ready, pup?
Yep.
They seeing it? So sorry you guys couldn't hear me. I just needed to show you guys the picture. I need you guys to show you what's coming in the next few days. So as of August the 7th, was I was trying to say when you guys couldn't hear me. August 6th, we're gonna be at Grizzly's Bar and Wyandotte kicking off the festival. We're gonna have Fabian's gonna be hosting the whole weekend for the festival, for the Freestyle Music Festival. We're gonna have Nana. We're gonna have Chicago's own Rudy Fausto. We're gonna have our brothers from another. We're gonna have Jesse Esco and Joel Rodriguez, the three wise men from Chicago, coming straight up to show us some love to kick off the festival. On top of that, that Friday night, we're gonna have TDMC. They're gonna be DJing along with Detroit DJ Dan and DJ Pup. Saturday, it's going to be at the 350 Terraces. We're going to have DME in the building. We're going to have Jesse B. We're going to have Diddle D. We're going to have Stephanie Bennett at the 350 Terraces rooftop. We're holding it down on the rooftop in the middle of downtown Detroit. Also, after that, on the same day, we're going to have the Freestyle Music Festival after party. Okay, it's going to be at the Sloppy Crab. That's a rooftop also. That day, we're going to have Detroit DJ Dan. We're going to have DJ Babel, Southwest Detroit's own DJ Babel. Will be, actually, no, I'm saying this a little bit too ahead. We're going to have another DJ from Detroit coming in. on top of that, we're going to have DJ Diamond. We're going to have DJ Low in the mix and DJ Chile from Chicago on Saturday night. Sunday, we're going to be at the St. Regis Hotel on August the 8th. St. Regis Hotel. There's going to be Fabian hosting the event, but also he's going to be performing. Also, with that said, we're going to have... this guy's throwing me off, yo. We're going to have Jenny Renee coming from Florida, and we're going to have Gennaro, legendary Gennaro, along at the St. Regis Hotel. So, get your tickets dropping tomorrow on Eventbrite. Tomorrow will be available. And I'm sending out all the invites to the event. Yo, it's gonna be the dopest freestyle event in Detroit. This summer, we're dropping it. We're dropping it hot like Lit Entertainment always does. So, with that said, shouts out again to F King Vodka. Shouts out to Detroit Forever 313, the El Nino Podcast. We got the 14K Pawn in Lincoln Park as a sponsor. We're going to have the St. Regis Hotel, the official hotel of the festival, and F. King Vodka, the official vodka of the festival. So, with that being said, yo, we got a lot of things we're working on here in Detroit. And, yo, much love to everybody that's on this chat room right now. Tonight, we have music producer. Also, he's an artist by the name of Luis Marte. We'll be in the building tonight here on Zoom. So, with that said, we're going to kick it with the hot mix. We're going to have Detroit DJ Dan and DJ Pup in the mix tonight. Yo, Dan, you ready?
Yes, sir.
Sorry it took us a little long just to make these announcements. So, again, the first annual Detroit Freestyle Music Festival will be in full effect. The tickets dropping tomorrow, August 6th, 7th, and 8th. Again, DME Music will be here August 7th at the 350 Terraces. So, with that said, let's get this party started. This is Freestyle After Dark. We'll see you guys in a few minutes with Luis. Holla.
Music.
Let's go! Share it up, people! Freestyle After Dark, you're in the mix with Detroit DJ Dan! Let's get it! Freestyle! DOC, what up, Joe? Let's go.
What up? world, it's your boy Jesse B, and you're listening to the sounds of DJ Punk from Lit Entertainment.
Everybody show some love to Louis Martin. Freestyle After Dark. Let's go. Official billboard of the Freestyle Music Festival. You didn't know, you better ask somebody.
This is your boy Louis Monte, and you're listening to my new single, 100 Miles Per Hour, with my man Detroit DJ Dan, Lit Music Entertainment. Keep it locked.
shout out to music recording artists. Antonio Mercado, he's on Twitter right now. Much love. Luis Marte track, Atomic Project. Alright. Shout out to Shine. Somebody tag him in. Happy birthday. Let's go.
What's up, Chad Miller? Definitely in the building representing.
So we're gonna drop it right now. As of Monday, we are gonna be on the Freestyle Radio. Freestyle Radio Monday for Live in the Mix. We're gonna be streaming through them too. So, if you didn't know, you better ask somebody. After all this time, I never thought it'd be this way. Ever.
Monte, and you in the mix with Detroit DJ Dan from Lit Music Entertainment. Keep it locked, y'all.
Shouts out to Mike Rabello from Boston. Lit Fam, what up, though? Much love. DME Dolls, where you at? Hot banger, 100 miles of running.
Detroit, this is your boy Louis Monte, and you tuned in to Jose Davale, aka Mr. Lit Entertainment himself, at the Freestyle After Dark Show. Keep it locked. This is your boy Louis Monte.
What's up, everybody? I want to welcome you back to Freestyle After Dark. I'm your host, Mr. Jose Del Valle, Mr. Lit Entertainment. I forgot my own name. Oh my God. Yo, we have one of Freestyle's, actually the music business, dopest producers in the game right now, Mr. Luis Marte. Yo, Pup, can you bring him in? What's up, Luis? How are you, brother?
What's up? What's up? What's up, Detroit? Stand up. What's going on, brother?
Man, yo, I'm so excited. I know we spoke about a week ago, or actually a few days ago, and it was really amazing the story that you had, and that, you know, you're not considered more as an artist. You just do it to stay relevant, but you're a producer. So, you know, the way I addressed this was like, yo, I want to talk to you as an artist. You're like, no. Hold on.
I didn't put it like that, but yeah, I feel you. Yeah, you're right.
Much love, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks for accepting the invite. Really. I know that we had something set up about a year ago with one of our former DJs, but I don't think it happened. So when Lit Entertainment, as us as a unit, decided to create this platform, we were really wanting to get deep into the game, into the music game. So let's talk about you. It's about tonight. It's about Luis Marte.
Yeah. Let's do it, man.
So, you said that you were born and raised in New York, correct?
Yeah, the BX, man. Born and raised.
BX. That's the Bronx, BX. For people that don't know. So, tell us more. You said that you moved to Florida, correct? Later in life?
Or? Yeah, man. You know, born and raised in the Bronx. It's where I did most of my early music. It's when I fell in love with freestyle music, fell in love with the music business in general. And, you know, I eventually ended up many, many years later. I think I moved to Florida like in 2004, and started a whole new chapter of my music career. But really, New York is where it all started.
Yeah. So New York. So currently you're in Central Florida, right?
Yeah. I'm in a little town called Davenport. So I'm right outside of Disney. So I get to,
you see Mickey Mouse and all that?
Goofy, yeah, Mickey Mouse and everything. Yeah.
Goofy be out there, you're chilling in the corner. But with that said, you've been in the game a long time. You said you've been doing this since like the 90s, right?
Early 90s. Yeah, definitely early 91s is when I kind of officially got into the game. I was actually brought into the game by the one and only the great Willie Valentin of Artistic Records. Early on, I mean, I knew Willie when his studio was in his bedroom in his mom's crib in Chelsea. That's the Willie I remember. That's how we met. You know, I've been recording with Willie for many, many years, and I often say this in many interviews, Willie is really the one who brought me into the game, who gave me my first break, my first record deal, opportunity to record music and write. And I'm indebted to him, not only as an artist, but, you know, he also taught me a little bit about how to produce, how to mess with the boards, and, you know, learn that whole piece of it. So that little taste eventually is what got me into that part of the game. So I always give ode whenever I can to Willie Valentin for doing that. He's done that for many artists. Wow. And, you know, I just want to make sure he gets his props.
That's dope. But again, you started as an artist, right? So yeah. What did you work on when Willie signed you?
Yeah, I was part of, fresh out of high school, I was part of a group, a duo, and we went by the name of On Two. So it was Henry Vargas and myself. And we were signed to Willie, initially under one of Willie's, newer labels, which was called AVP. Actually, and funny story is, it's the same label that Jay Allen started from as well. We were label mates. So we were on that first compilation together. And so we ended up, you know, recording for many years with Willie. We did many compilations. We ended up with the first album, freestyle album for New School. It was called Can We Go Back? So I was rocking with On 2 for a hot minute, you know, for I think from 91 to about 95, 96. We were performing everywhere. We were doing all the shows. I mean, I used to do shows with Vocal Image and Lorenzo Dillon and Pose, Willie Valentin himself. I mean, all of us kind of grew up together in New School Freestyle. And that really was the time when New School Freestyle was kind of making its way, making an impact. I mean, those are all
my question to you is this. What is New School Freestyle? Because, I mean, you say you're talking about this is like the early 90s, right?
Yep.
And that's considered New School?
It was, yeah. Here's, I mean, for us old heads, the way it worked is old school was, of course, the legends, right? George Lamont, the Judy Torreses, and all those folks. That style of music started fading out around 91, 92. And New School was basically a new batch of artists that were coming out. The one thing we had going against us is we weren't getting the radio play that old school used to get, right? Because that kind of died out. Those stations moved from freestyle to hip hop, especially in New York. And so we didn't have that platform. We were considered new school because we were the new blood. And, you know, but we had a higher stairs to climb and more challenges because we didn't have radio. So, yeah, okay. I mean, I consider myself new school because we started back in when I think about new school, I think about artistic records. And that's really and not only artistic records, but on the other side, forget the name, the same label that Payne was on, Metropolitan, like those labels, that was all considered new school.
Let me ask you this, because I've never asked this question and I've interviewed numerous artists. Like after the radio stopped playing, right? Freestyle. How was your music heard? Like, was it all underground?
Absolutely. It was all grassroots, man. We pounded the pavement. We were doing shows everywhere, Massachusetts, New York, Philly, Miami. I mean, we were wherever we can go and we can be heard. That's what we were doing. And back then, you know, back then there was no Facebook, there's no social media, there's barely internet, you know what I'm saying? So it was all really word of mouth, underground, and you know, Willie and his iconic artistic sound kept that music alive for a long time. And
wow.
You know, I don't know that he gets credited for that, but he really put New School on the map, and still does today.
Wow. Wow. So no social media, hitting the ground.
Imagine that.
Wow. Now, have you guys ever done, like, it's mostly here in Detroit, it's all underground, man, especially with freestyle. You know what I'm saying? So have you done any shows personally in Detroit?
No, I've never performed in Detroit.
Really?
Yeah, we'd love to. Wow.
Well, we'll talk about that real soon. You know, I hear that, you know, you told me that you've worked with numerous artists under Artistic, correct?
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
Who are those artists? Or a few.
Well, Lorenzo Dillon. I've done stuff with Pose. And that's from the 90s, but, you know, I'm talking about in terms of now. Are you talking about in terms of now or back then?
Back then. We're talking about back then. We'll talk about now later.
Yeah, I mean, back then, remember, back then I was an artist. My whole focus was being an artist, and I knew nothing really about what I do now. I wasn't really doing songwriting recording studio or engineering. I kind of learned that as I went, but my focus back then in the 90s was being an artist. I wanted to be famous, bro. I wanted to get all the girls and be on stage, and that's what I wanted to do. And that was my focus. It wasn't about the business side. That didn't come until later on in life.
Right. So how long were you particularly an artist? To what period?
Yeah,
what gave you that epiphany?
Yeah. So I mean, the way that I'll make it real brief, the timeline goes is I got into freestyle early 91, 90. I rocked with Onto and Artistic Records for about 5 years. Then I transitioned into pop music. So I left freestyle. I formed a pop group, a boy band group, named Strange Ways. It was four of us from the neighborhood. And that's really where I had the most success in my career. With Strange Ways, we ended up signing a deal with Hollywood Records. We were the opening act for 98 Degrees. And if folks don't remember 98 Degrees, they were like similar to Backstreet Boys and NSYNC. So we were the opening act on tour. Yeah. So we were on tour with them, you know, doing stadiums, 30,000 plus. So
do you got the 98 Degrees tattoo? Do you got that?
I got it on my leg. No, I want to get it. But that was a crazy experience, man. There's nothing like being in a stadium with 30,000 screaming girls going nuts. So that was an amazing experience for us. We ended up doing a Disney Channel show called 2 Hour Tour. So we were on Disney Channels for a couple of months. We did a show with Enrique Iglesias. We were on tour with him. So we had a lot of great success in my pop career side, and that really gave me a taste of the business. Cause there's nothing like the business on that level. Right. And then, and then after Strange Ways and that pop sound kind of died out, if you think about it, you know, we died out around the same time as Backstreet Boys and NSYNC kind of died out, and the whole Latin explosion happened. So we're talking about like the Ricky Martins and the Jennifer Lopez. Mm-hmm. When that started happening, our sound wasn't relevant anymore. So that's when I made the move to Florida. And when I made the move to Florida, that's when everything switched.
So I'm seeing in my notes here, Strange Ways was basically the Latin version of boy bands, right?
Absolutely, correct, yep.
And who did you work with that particular group?
Anybody we know? We worked with some big players. One of the biggest was Jim Beans. He goes by Jimba. He's the one who did all the production with P. Diddy, Day 26. We were behind the scenes of when they were doing the whole creating a boy band on MTV. So we were involved with that team and those producers creating music for us. Eventually, I mean, we did a tour with Mario and B2K. We were doing some big things back then, shortly after Strange Ways, because Strange Ways kind of turned into another group. It turned into a group called Forecast, which was more R&B. And that's when we did all that cool stuff. So I've been around, man. It's been a little roller coaster.
So you've met B2K then, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because Omarion, that's my dude. Always
a beast.
Yeah. You got to meet him in person?
I met the whole group.
Wow, yo.
Yeah.
You didn't tell me this. You did not tell me this.
My bad. it was a short time period because Strange Ways, like I said, the pop sound died out and the producers wanted to reform our group. So we lost a couple of members, a couple of new members came in, and we formed a new group called Forecast. And we were in the process. We had recorded a bunch of great songs and we were prepping the tour to go on tour with B2K. So we spent some time with them rehearsing and that kind of stuff. But, you know, that never panned out, eventually. And so, you know, I didn't get a chance to do big tours with them, but I did get a chance to meet them and kind of go through that process.
That's so dope. So what happened after that, experience? Because now we're talking about mid, 2005, like 2004?
Yeah, I would say 2002, between 2002, 2003. I have a family, wife and children, and we ended up, picking up out of New York and we moved down to Florida. When I moved down to Florida, I left all the artist stuff behind. I wasn't an artist anymore. I wasn't doing music that way anymore. And then that's when I fell in love with, building a recording studio, learning that process, songwriting, producing, and I just honed my skills on that. And I worked with a ton of artists during that time in early 2004, 2005 in Florida, and I haven't looked back since.
So the experiences they've had with the pop game, that like really inspires a lot of your music now, what you produce?
Yeah, absolutely. When people ask me, you know, what is my first love or the genre that I go to the most, it's pop music. It's always been for me pop music. And it still is today. Even when I do freestyle, I always infuse pop into either my writing or the vocal arrangements or the harmonies, backgrounds. It's just that's what I do. I feel that's what I do best, and that's what I try to. That's the lane that I've built for myself as Luis Marte, and that's the lane that I want to stay in.
Wow, you know what? When we spoke, you said something inspiring that Willie told you, and it was said. He said something to you that said, "Stop being an artist and start being industry." Was that around the time inspired this?
Yeah, well, this was actually recently. You know, Willie has seen me grow from not knowing anything, right, a hungry artist, to where I'm at today, and it was one of the biggest compliments. It was an interview, or I think he said something in a chat, where he said, you know, that because he's seen my growth and where I've come from, it amazed him that to see me go from artist to now industry, right? Where now artists are coming to me for help to write songs or do production for them or get them to the next level. And that was a big compliment because, you know, coming from him, number one, I always consider him, you know, a mentor and a teacher. And it's weird because I've always worked with Willie as producer and I'm the artist, right? And now I find myself, even yesterday I had a conversation with Willie. We're having producer to producer conversations, right? We're talking about stems and production and sessions and Pro Tools, and it's different kind of conversation that I had 20 years ago with Willie. So it was great to hear that from him.
Now, do you feel Willie molded you into what you are now? Like,
I think he had a part to do with it. Yeah, I think he had a part of it. I mean, I've had a lot of experience since freestyle, especially in the pop and R&B world. So I've had many folks in my life who've molded me, you know, mm-hmm. in different ways. So he's definitely part of it. I give him credit for, you know, getting me started and giving me the opportunity to do something I love. But there's been many folks along the way who have helped me hopefully become what I am now and continue to grow.
Yeah. Wow. That's so dope. So did you took a break from freestyle, obviously, went into these different genres. You're producing. When did you decide to resubmerge to do did you always do the freestyle thing?
Yeah. I mean, that's an excellent question, man. Cause I what happened was after I moved to Florida and I started doing stuff in the background, you know, I'm doing writing and producing for other artists, you know, as an artist, and any artist can tell you this, once an artist, always an artist. You're always going to have the bug. You're always going to have that desire to do what you love, right? And
right.
I still love recording music. I still love writing my own songs. Happened? I still love performing. So at some point, that bug is going to take over and kind of push me to do it again. And so I think after a while, I started seeing a little bit of a resurgence of new school freestyle in the market. I'm going to say around 2012 to 2013, around that time. And I got with Angel Mena. Angel Mena is, of course, the label owner of NSR. And so he approached me that he was working on a compilation project, his first compilation project. And, that was my first kind of song back into freestyle. I was on his first compilation. Actually, I was on compilation 1, 2, and 3. And that's really what got me back into freestyle. And I started recording under the name Luis Marte. So that was the first birth of Luis Marte, the artist. So that was really cool.
Wow.
NSR.
Wow. And you worked on... Did you still work in the background with some other genres? I know you said you worked on some bachata records.
Yeah. Right before I got back into freestyle, I was doing more stuff in the Latin market. I was writing for acts like Toby Love, who's a big bachata artist, Leslie Grace, who's another great bachata artist. I did some songs for her. See, she actually has a movie coming out now, In the Heights, that's going to be on HBO Max. I think that comes out this week. So I'm super proud of her. So I did a lot of work on bachata side, Latin side, wrote a ton of songs. I got signed to a publishing deal during that time, Pure Music out of Miami. So I got a bunch of song placements. I was working with Enrique Iglesias again. So I was doing a lot of Latin stuff. Now, being I'm terrible singing in Spanish.
Okay.
I can write it. I can write songs and I can demo them, of course. So I never had an interest in being a Latin artist, but I loved working in the Latin market. It's a booming market. There was a lot of opportunity, and I had a lot of fun doing that.
How was the experience working with Julio? Enrique. But you met Julio too, right?
No. I didn't mean Enrique. Just his son, Enrique.
Just his son.
Yeah.
How was that experience?
Yeah, Enrique is cool, man. There's a YouTube video floating around. If you search "Strange Ways" to our tour, you'll find a video on YouTube of the Disney Channel special we had with Enrique. And we spent a lot of time with Ricky. We did a couple of radio shows with him. We did concerts. We opened up for him. We had some one-on-one time with him. I'm not in touch with Enrique anymore. He's a big boy now. So
yeah, he's conglomerate now.
Yeah, absolutely. I wish Enrique, if you're listening, hit me up.
Hit him up.
He's down to earth, cool, and give us a lot of good advice. And he was a good friend.
Wow. Wow. So 2013, you're working on a compilation album with Julio Mena. What happened after that?
That's it. I mean, I kept doing freestyle. So every year I would work on a single every year. I've worked with Yu-Yo MC. I work with Willie again. I did some stuff with Angel Mena. I just kept going. And I think, like you alluded to before, and we had this kind of conversation offline, a lot of the questions I get from a lot of people is why I'm not performing, why you don't see Luis Marte on these shows, right? And it's because, my focus has been in the studio working with other artists. And I get a lot of joy out of helping another artist reach their potential, either through my writing, through coaching them through a vocal session, producing a record for them. That's where I get my joy, man. And I love doing it. And that's what I've been doing in and out. So, I do a freestyle record at least once a year. I try to do a single, and that's really to stay in the conversation so that people don't forget about me, Luis Marte, the artist. No, I can still throw down. I can still do great songs.
I had a good friend of mine. She actually came here to the studio, Evelina Destiny,
from SCR. Of course, yeah.
And she was like, Jose, actually, she just texted me. She's like, tell him, I forgot, I got to look at the text, but she said hi.
What's up, Evelina?
But yeah,
I did some stuff for her. I did a duet with her.
Yeah.
I've done a lot of work with her.
Yeah, I think XO is one of them. Right?
XO is one of them, absolutely.
XO, that's actually DJ Dan's top track. He loves that track. He loves it. And, we've had her here, and, she told us the experience that she had with you, So I'm telling Dan, play XO. And he's like, no, that's Evelina's track. I said, Luis Marte, he does his thing on the track, and he's like, no, I didn't know that. I said, bro, we got the record right here. My man's, he's just right here in the picture.
Very true, yeah.
So who are you producing for now? What you got your label now, right? LMM?
Yep. Luis Marte Music. Right now we are working with on the new TKA project, so Actual. We're doing a couple of songs for them. We're doing a song for AB Cruz. He's doing a separate project as well. So we're excited to be working with them. I'm working with Touch of Quality on their new stuff. So I got a couple of songs with them. Of course, I recently just did the Rebecca Over You track.
Dope track.
Of course, working within my camp with DJ Merc One and Marilyn Torres. You know, I was part of Exchange for What, her last single. And, you know, I continue. Merc One and I are partners, and we that's all we've been doing, man. We've been grinding out, writing tracks, producing. So we have a ton of records that are going to be coming out this year that we've either produced or penned.
Wow, yo.
Yeah. It's been busy.
So what's your experience right now as you're, as you are a producer compared to the artist now? Now that you're in the producer side, do you see some of the traits that you had and other artists now that, that you work with now?
Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah, it makes sense. It gives me the opportunity to live through their music, right? So if I have an opportunity to write a song for someone, then it has Luis Marte's sound. It has a touch. If I get to mix someone's vocals, I get to record someone or help them vocal arrange or do their harmonies or backgrounds, it just allows me to have a connection, even if I'm not doing my own music. So that's the joy you get out of doing that. And I've had some great moments in the studio with other artists. I've had artists cry, like, I never thought I can sound like this, you know, things like that. Just make it all worthwhile, you know, all the work that we're doing here. So I'm very happy, very proud to be doing what we're doing at Luis Marte Music and DJ Merc One. And you know, we're doing what we can to keep this, this genre, our genre, freestyle music alive and kicking, man.
You know what? And it's kind of hard on a promoter side, you know. I've had a little bit of negativity, and not to talk negative, but
no, it's okay.
I had other promoters in this area. They're like, Jose, like, why are you pushing freestyle? And I'm like, I'm pushing it to the fullest because I believe there's a culture to this, you know, and a lot of things were taken away from us as Latinos, or not even just as Latinos, but in music in general, you know. And I just started doing the freestyle thing maybe about 2 years ago, you know, when we started Lit Entertainment, and we were just focused on hip hop, doing events. But now through the pandemic, and how it actually helped, freestyle made me get through these hard times, you know, and be creative, you know? So
absolutely, man. It's always been our music, man. Always from the very beginning. And, you know, if we don't support each other and lift each other up, and I'm not just saying personally, but musically, you know, if we got to make sure that we're all doing great music. Because if you have bad music in the group, and, you know, a bad apple in the bunch, then, you know, it ruins the bunch. So we got to make sure we protect our brand, protect our genre, so that, you know, at sooner or later, George Lamont's and the Coros and Judy Torres's of the world are not going to be able to perform anymore. You know, they're going to get to that age, and, you know, we don't want our music to die, you know, when they're no longer able to do it. So we want to make sure that we carry that mantle. It's a hard road because we're fighting, you know, we don't have an audience or platforms like we used to. Obviously, we have internet and we have, you know, great platforms like yours.
Thank you.
And that's why it's so valuable. So, you know, it's super valuable what you guys do.
You know what? I didn't know that. You know, when we first created this, I didn't think it was going to be, you know, like, beneficial, you know. And
out to the year.
Yeah, like I'm hearing it now. I'm hearing it from you. I'm hearing it from a lot of artists, you know. When I go to a concert and I see Cynthia and I don't know her, you know, from nothing, and she's like, I know who you are.
That's dope.
Yeah, and I'm like, whoa. And this just transpired in this pandemic, you know. Yeah. What do you see in the near future, like for freestyle, like for the music? Do you think that it's going to get some radio play? Do you think that there's tracks out here that, and you, I'm talking to you as a producer, that can actually make it to the mainstream?
I think that is the catalyst. I think that right there would be the point where it turns. I think if it hits, if it hits mainstream radio loud enough, where, you know, maybe not to the level that it was in the late 80s and early 90s, but at some level, I think that will be the turning point for our music. You know, and I think one of the conversations I always have with an artist is, you know, don't try to replicate what was, try to create what's new, you know, mm-hmm. create a lane, something new, fresh, that will get us over that hump. So doing the same is never going to work. And that's the definition of insanity, right? So, you know, absolutely. I always encourage an artist to do that. You know, part of what Louis Mart the Music does and our lane and our brand is, you know, I try to make pop records. When I write for myself, you know, I don't make freestyle records. I never write to freestyle tracks. I never say I'm going to make a freestyle record. I make a record that I love, right? So I make a pop record, whether it's over acoustic guitar or it's over a piano track. That's my intent. I make it that way. And then we take it and say, okay, well, let's mold it now into freestyle or into house or into dance and see if we can make it work. If it works, great. If it doesn't, then it stays the way it is. But I need to make music that I love, that I'm passionate about. And I think if every artist does that, approaches it that way and tries not to make freestyle records, just make records, make good songs. Eventually they'll make it to the ears that they need to make it to, but just make good music.
Do you think, again, talking industry, do you think that these new or these, radio directors or radio station directors, you think that are they older? I mean, are they new school? Or they're kind of like, you know, what ages are these people?
Yeah, I was, for the ones that I've encountered, most of them are old guard, right? They are older, used to how things were, and it's gonna take a very innovative risk taker of a music supervisor or you know, a music director at a radio station to be open enough to hear something new and take a chance. And that's really what it is, and that's what it was back in the in late 80s and early 90s. You know, freestyle music didn't exist before 82, 83. But it took radio to take a chance on it, right? A new sound, and that's what happened. It'll get there, you know. It may not. Music is always in cycles, you know. Their styles come, styles go, and at some point, we just can't give up making the music that we love. You know, if we give up, then it'll die that way. So we gotta just keep doing it, and hopefully find someone who believes enough in it.
You know what? 2 years ago, I was introduced to a track. A new school freestyle. It was Jay Mazur. And I'm listening to this track. I'm like, holy shit, what is this? And they're like, yo, that's freestyle. I'm like, no, that ain't no freestyle. And they're like, yeah, that's new freestyle. That's new school. Like, in the last few years, let's say from 2015 to what's going on now, to what, 2021? Let's say, not even say that. 2018. Have you seen a difference in terms of people's interest in the music?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I want to jump back to Jay Mazur for a second. He's another example of an artist who's doing it right. Right. Jay Mazur, his passion, he's R&B. He's always been that way. He's done a lot of records in R&B, but he brought that to freestyle, right? He didn't lose his identity or who he was. He cultivated it and made freestyle come to him. So that's a good example of doing it the right way. Now, in terms of, you know, movement of the freestyle industry, I think, yes, I think over the past 2 years, we're starting to see more shows with new school freestyle artists and a mix of old school freestyle artists, which was non-existent 3 or 4 years ago. You wouldn't catch a new school artist, a George Anthony, on a Sal Abatello show in New York. Now you can, right? So I am seeing, you know, and even to have K7 invite me into his world to write songs for him, that's a whole nother, you know, and I've had the conversation with him recently where he's told me that. He said, you know, I've learned to let go, is what he told me. You know, and that, and part of that is, you know, allowing a new artist or a younger artist to come in and inspire him and write a different way, do a different kind of TKA record. So I think there is a changing of the guard. I think they're opening up a little more. And I have seen a lot of positive I'm excited about.
Yeah. I think I've seen an example of that at the White Party in Florida, in Fort Lauderdale, mm-hmm. with Miami Mike and the Blend Junkies. When they did their thing out in back in March, it was amazing seeing that, because I seen Jenny Renee, I seen Cynthia, Julio Menas, I seen George Anthony, I seen Nelson Rego and Reynaldo, you know, and they were all together and they're all performing. And that's, it was just dope. Like, yo, like, this is the shit.
And it wasn't like that 2-3 years ago, for sure.
Really? And I don't know nothing about that, because I was just too busy over here, you know, working my little events here in Detroit.
Yeah.
But yo, like, that was a great experience, and I brought that back with me, and that's what kind of inspired this festival coming in August.
Which I wanted great, to mix, by the way, man. It's such a great thing that you guys are doing.
You know what? We've been kind of pushed to the corner. And, you know, when your back is against the wall, and now we're going to come out swinging. So I take it that way. But I am glad that I can contribute. I'm glad that producers like yourself, actually, it's 12:19 right now. And, you know, you're talking to me. We're talking on Zoom.
And it's my pleasure, brother.
Man, it's nothing but a privilege and an honor. Thank you. Let's talk about, not you've done stuff with Niaja, right? Because I had Niaja here a few weeks ago.
Yeah, I recorded, Niaja did a single with Santana Twins, and forgive me, I have a plaque on the wall, I gotta look back and remember the song. I think remember, yeah, that was her single, Remember. Yeah, she recorded that here in my studio with the Santana Twins. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I've done stuff with Giggles. I've done stuff with Niaja, and more. Yeah, I mean, I work with a lot of the old school artists as well.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, one more question. What's the difference? What's the difference between you working with an old school artist to working with a new school artist? What's the differences? I mean, is it a different world? Is it, you know, are they inspired by the same thing?
That's an excellent question. I see no difference. I think when you look at an artist, when they are in the recording world, right, when they're in the creative space, in a studio, we are all equal. We all share the same desires. We go through the same trials and tribulations on, you know, making sure that this sounds right. Oh, can we change this lyric? Oh, add more reverb to this or whatever it is. You know, it's all the same world. We're in a creative space. And when you're in that creative space as an artist, you're open. You know, you're excited, you're open. And I've never felt any differently recording on Niaja versus Ricky Vaz, for example. You know, it's the same. We go through the same motions. Outside of the studio, that may be different. You know, they may be treated differently outside the studio, but when you're in the studio, you're doing the same job. You're creating. So I've never seen a difference in working with old school versus new school.
Wow. That's crazy. Cause I would think that, you know, with, what's the youngest artist you've worked with? In freestyle.
Probably 15, 16.
In freestyle?
No, not in freestyle. No, not in freestyle. In freestyle, I would say, I've been doing stuff with Reek and Touch. They're a young group. But other than that, I mean, mostly have been either my age, you know, late 30s, all the way up to, you know, mid 40s. And keeping in mind, you know, when you're in a recording studio with an artist, that artist is vulnerable, right? So what do you tell Niaja if she's off key? You know what I'm saying? It's Niaja.
Niaja, you're right.
What do you tell K7 if he's not singing that verse right? You know what I'm saying? Those So when you're in the studio, you have to be in that kind of mindset where I'm here to help. We're here to help create. We're going to make mistakes. That's what the studio is for. A studio is for you to make mistakes. That's where you want to make them, in the studio, right? So it's a different world, man. You know, it's definitely a different world.
Yeah, that's a good question. You just asked yourself a question. How is that? How is that conversation? To tell Nyasia, hey, you off key, girl. Like, bro, that sounds horrible.
Yeah, and I've had those conversations with some big artists.
No, shit.
But it's all good. That's what you're in the studio for, and that's what they expect of you. So,
wow. Hard
job. Somebody got to do it.
You also have done some work with Alex of Latin Nation, right?
Yeah. I did a whole album for him. I've done a couple of freestyle stuff for him, but I've done more. He comes to me mostly for non-freestyle. So I do a lot of pop EDM for him. I did his record. I'm sorry. I got to look. There's another plaque on the wall. You Found One. So his latest album called You Found One. I was basically the executive producer for that. I think I did like 5 songs on his album, and all of them are not freestyle. So they're all like pop, R&B, EDM. I did a lot of work with Alex.
So how many plaques you got up there, man? Because I've seen you look 2 different directions here. What's going on back there, bro?
I got a lot, man. I think maybe maybe 20 plaques, all different genres of music. I've done comedy albums. So I've had a comedy artist come here and record a comedy album. I've done gospel, Christian. The whole gamut. You know, it keeps me on my toes, man.
Comedy album. I never heard of imagine that. Like that.
Yeah.
Yo, how do you do that? How do you produce that? Like, tell me what's the process. What's the process in that?
You turn the mic on. He tells jokes. You record it. You mix it, and you make it into an album. He's an older gentleman. He does cruise lines, so he's like the comedians that go when you go on a cruise.
Okay.
And so he produced a CD album to sell while he's doing the cruises shows. So yeah, we produced a whole album.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yo, that's so dope. That's yo, I like, I'm speaking to you now because I'm comfortable. You know, when we spoke a few days ago, I was nervous as hell. I was like, I don't even know where to start with this guy. And then, you know, this is amazing, man. But again, one thing that really stuck out of our conversation was what Willie told you, you know, stop being an artist, be industry. And it stuck. I don't know why it did. I kind of relate to it, you know. Stop being a promoter, be industry, you know. Mm-hmm. And that was inspiring me. That kind of, now I'm turning the notch now, you know. Now I gotta look at things differently.
Yeah.
So future projects, what are you working on?
I continue to do my music. Of course, I just released 100 Miles Per Hour, the EP. I think it has like 8 mixes on it. And I'm really proud of that project because the 8 mixes that you hear, I have, you know, a 1987 remix. I have an R&B remix.
The radio is dope. The radio version, the radio one is, that's the one I actually played for your, when I was doing your flyer.
Dope. Yeah, I love. Yeah. And I got a lot of good feedback on that. A lot of folks love that house and the progressive house and the dance versions, you know, and we try to cater to as many genres as possible, you know, and we only have 1 freestyle mix on that EP. But the cool story behind 100 Miles Per Hour is that when I originally wrote that song, I wrote it as an acoustic song, just to guitar.
Wow.
And I sent that, and similar to Apology IOU. So I wrote the song, I sent it to Merc One. Merc One started producing, and he came up with the dance version. And then we started going from there. So for that EP, I actually recorded the vocals maybe 3 or 4 times. So when you listen to the EP, there are almost 3 or 4 different sets of vocals. And what I did was when Merc One gives me a track, I interpret the track and I re-record the vocals, as opposed to just taking the vocals and putting it on the track as is. We actually go back in the studio, I'll re-record the verses, I'll re-record the hook, I'll change words, I'll change the key, just because I want the song to the lyrics to be married to the type of beat. So on this EP, I have EDM, house music, R&B, freestyle, you can't sing those all the same way. You know, they have different feels, different textures to them. So I treated each one almost like an individual single, even though they're all the same song. So we're really proud. And like I said before, man, I take my time with all my singles. Sometimes they take a year to mm-hmm. put together, because I painstakingly go through the whole process to make sure it is perfect, man. Perfect lyrically, perfect mixed wise, music wise. And that's why it takes so long with my music. I want to make sure that my next song is better than my last. And my last song was Apology IOU. And
that was a big banger.
Record for me.
That was a banger.
Big record. Yeah.
But you know what I don't like calling tracks a banger? Because it seems so short term, you know? That track, Apology IOU, I actually heard about it for the first time through Jose CPR. Okay, Jose Ortiz. Yeah. And he was like, I like, you know, he's always griping about, you know, clean freestyle music and, you know, we shouldn't be playing all of it. And, you know, I kind of understand it now. But that was one of the tracks that he particularly said, yo, this is a clean, this is well produced, well put together, and this is what we should be playing. And I listened to that track and I was like, wow, okay, now I understand, you know, what the process is. Tell me about that track. What inspired that? Apology IOU.
Yeah, I mean, I love that song, and that's probably one of my favorite songs of my career thus far. That was actually the first song that I wrote and produced with Merc One. That's how Merc One and I kind of got together. That was our first project together. And what a project it was, you know. And I ended up, you know, we ended up recording the song. And the inspiration really behind it was, if you listen to the record, it's slower than most freestyle. And it reminded me of Louder Than Love, TKA's Louder Than Love. It had that same kind of feel, that same flow. There's even at the end of the song, it modulates to a different key, which is very rare in freestyle now. And I can't, maybe there's a handful of songs that do that. And Louder Than Love was one of those songs. So that's really where the inspiration came from. And, you know, and we ended up shopping that record to 418 Music. And 418 Music was the go-to and probably still is the big go-to freestyle label in our industry right now. And I was excited that they picked me up. I got to work with Carlos Berrios, who's a legend in our game. And you know, they kind of, you know, they put the song around their arm, supported it, and it became one of my biggest records. And it was very, and when it came out, it came out last year in March. It was different from everything else that was out. It was a different kind of freestyle.
Right. It was
more of a pop freestyle, a slower freestyle. Not that boom bap that you've been constantly getting hit with. So we were very proud of that record.
Wow. That's amazing, man. That's amazing. So what's next for LMM?
I mean, we're going to continue writing. Like I said, we're doing stuff. We're excited to be doing stuff with TKA. They're going to come out with their project called Actual. So we're super excited to hear K and AB on those songs. We're working with a bunch of other artists who are releasing music this year. Touch of Quality is another one. We did two songs for them. So, you know, right now we're just doing what we do. We're staying to our formula, keep working the way we're working, writing songs and producing for other folks and see where it goes. I'm for me as an artist, I'm now working on some pop records. So I have a couple of pop records that I've completed already. We're shopping for a deal in the UK right now to see if we can blow up out there. So on my pop game. So I'm almost got that feeling of going back to the Strange Ways days, you know, go back to the pop and hit those stadiums. And so that's really what my goal is as an artist. But for the business, we're mm-hmm. going to kind of keep doing what we're doing to help this genre
make
stay alive.
Go forward.
Yeah.
Where can we get your music?
You can get everything Luis Marte at luismartemusic.com. You can get all my music. You can order all my music in CD or vinyl or digital download, or you can get the links to all the Spotify and Apple Music and Amazon, wherever you buy digital music. I got a ton of merchandise, t-shirts, and all kind of cool stuff on that site. And also, if you want to learn a little bit about me and kind of my past and what I've done, you want to learn about what we're doing now, recording studio, you can see the recording studio, the services we provide. So it's kind of an all encompass one place to go, one-stop shop, lewismartemusic.com.
Do you do mastering?
Yep, we do mixing, mastering, audio editing. I do podcasting. I have a podcast.
Really?
Musically Speaking with Lewis and Pedro. It's all over. It's on Spotify. It's on Apple Music. You can subscribe and check out the podcast. All we talk about is the music industry, and not just freestyle. We talk about the music industry as a whole. So we have great conversations on the podcast. I'm very proud. We put a episode out every week, so we're up to episode 72. So wow. We've been doing this for a hot minute. So definitely check out the podcast. I have a blog on my website. So everything is on my website, all one place. So lewismartemusic.com.
That's so dope. Actually, I'm interested because I've been trying to get, we do work a podcast here too. So besides our Live in the Mix Monday on Mondays, which is our freestyle mix show, and Freestyle After Dark, we do one called The Real Everyday People. And I've been trying to find different platforms to where we can actually make a difference. I'd like to talk to you after this, you know.
For sure. Hit me up.
I'll hit you up sometime next week and see where, you know, see where you could probably guide me to you know, take this podcast Absolutely. Somewhere.
You got it.
Sir, it's really, really a pleasure. Thank you so much. Man, thank you for accepting the invite. And this means a lot to us here in Detroit, you know. And we hope to see you here soon.
Yeah, I would perform. Love that. Absolutely. Yeah, good luck with the festival. Much success with the festival, man. That's a big move. I hope it goes well. And, you know, I want to thank everyone who stood up with us this late, you know, who's still hanging on, checking us out. Yeah, you know,
who's rocking with us? How many people rocking with us?
I don't know. It's been fluctuating.
Okay. It's fluctuating. Right now, okay. You know, I moved this show an hour earlier, you know, because I had this going till like 2 a.m.
Yo, when you're talking about music, man, time flies.
Yeah, it does. Well, Lewis, man, much love. Thank you, man. Thank you. And, I'll get you a gift to an invite out here just to come out and chill for that festival.
Yeah, that'd be dope, bro. That'd be dope.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I got a lot of friends out there, so we love to hook up with everybody.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, all right, brother, again, appreciate you.
You have a good night.
Yeah, absolutely. All the DJs, DJ Pub, DJ Dan, Detroit Dan, just I love you guys. You guys are rock, bro. Appreciate
Thank you,
it.
Man. Thank you.
Doing what you do.
You have a good night, man.
You too, brother. Deuce.
All right. All right, Dan. All right, people. So, this is Freestyle After Dark, as you already know. That was music producer from LMM. Check him out on lewismarte.com. Pick up his music. Dope interview. I think this is the kind of one of the most funnest interviews I've been on in a while. So, what we're going to do, we're going to have DJ Pup jumping on the mix tonight. And after that, what we're gonna do, we're gonna take a few song requests and we're gonna try to end this by 1 o'clock. So keep it locked right here. Let's go.
Love can be so cruel. Just when I think I'm winning, I'ma lose.
What up, tell people? And bring you peace. Freestyle after turn. You're in the hot mix with DJ Pop. Let's go. Shout out to everybody on this chat room right now. Shut up. Let's get it. Tattoo Lewis Marte showing us love here at Lit Music Entertainment. Spin that shit up. Let's bang it out. What's up, Germany? Good morning. Much love from Detroit. Shout out to music recording artist Lit's own Nori Vell is in the building. Sponsors F. King Bacta and the official hotel of the Freestyle Music Festival, St. Regis Hotel, Detroit. August 6th, 7th, and 8th, the Freestyle Music Festival,
live here from Detroit. You didn't know, you better ask somebody. Tickets drop tomorrow. So that lit request line is open. This is Freestyle After Dark. Bringing in nothing but the hotness. I made you cry. Now I ask myself why. I should have let you go. You in the mix with Detroit Sound. DJ Puck. Ruff, ruff. This track is requested by Mike Rapello from Boston. Let's own. Faded Love by Detroit Zone. Nora Evel featured on this track. You didn't know, you better ask somebody. Carl Smith Studio. The official freestyle recording studio in Detroit. Tap in. Dark. You didn't know, you better ask somebody. This reminds me of the club right here. Freestyle forever, people. Freestyle lives. Monday night for Live in the Mix Monday. We're going to be in the mix with Detroit DJ Dan and DJ Puck, holding it down for the Live in the Mix show Monday night. 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Central, 4 p.m. Pacific. And next Friday night, we're gonna have something special for you. We're gonna have Latin icon Tito Puentes Jr. will be in the building for Freestyle After Dark next Friday night. And as you already know, August 6th, 7th, and 8th of 2021, Lit Music Entertainment is bringing it to you live here in Detroit for the first annual Detroit Freestyle Music Festival. Tickets are dropping tomorrow. Get yours. Brought to you by Soundsmith Studios, St. Regis Hotel, Forever 313. So, we will see you guys next Friday, next Monday night, 7 p.m. And for Freestyle After Dark next week. Holla. We keep it lit. How about you? One more track and we done. This was another episode of Freestyle After Dark. Bringing it to you live from Lit Music Entertainment Studios here in Detroit. Let's end it. I think this is Pop's favorite track right here. Much love, people. See you guys Monday, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, live in a mix.